Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My special co-host this time out is Joan Willshire, and she's got a special guest, and I actually have two today, Nikki Villavicencio and Daryl Paulson. They're going to talk about a new kitchen remodel they got at their house. It's a great story, so stay tuned. And Joan has a special guest for her own. She wants to tell us. Joan, go
right.
ahead.
Right. Sue Redepenning, who's the occupational therapist and CEO of a company that works on technology in the home. So it's a fantastic project, and it's going to help a lot of people either move into their own home or definitely stay in their home.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be a fast-moving half hour, so stay tuned to Disability Viewpoints, which is coming up next.
Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My name is Joan Willshire. I will be the co-host for this segment. And with me today, my guest is Sue Redepenning. She's an occupational therapist and is also CEO of Home for Technology. So we're really thrilled to have you today. And we're excited to learn all about technology in our home.
Great.
Yeah. So I know, Sue, you and I, we've known each other for several years. And your background is occupational therapy. Mm-hmm. So why don't you start from the beginning and talk to us about the program that you're working with. And I know it started back in 2013 with a large grant, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. Thank you for having me, too. It's been great. The company that I own is called Live Life Therapy Solutions. And that's a company that has the grant called Technology for Home. In our grant, we have had since 2013. And we partner with DHS, Disability Services Unit. And so that grant started in March of 2013. And we were, at that point, going to be serving the whole state of Minnesota for assistive technology, which
wow.
is what we do now, too. And at first, DHS had thought that assessments were what was needed. And so we're occupational therapists, physical therapists, assistive technology professionals, and we do have speech therapists too. And so we did start for the first year doing assessments only, feeling that once we did the assessment and the person got the technology, then someone else would be able to do the training.
Sure.
That was not where the need was. Well, we quickly found out that was not true. And so DHS did a really great job with us to pivot with our data to show that we do need to do assessment and training. Because if you don't do training, that's where abandonment occurs. And abandonment is when someone gets some great technology and it sits in the corner,
sits in their closet.
And nobody wants that, but it happens a lot. So in my previous career, prior to getting this grant, I used to work at Courage Center.
Sure.
And I worked at hospitals, too, as an occupational therapist doing assistive technology. And when I would go out into the home and do home care, I would see all this technology that was great and would be sitting in the closet or on the back porch. And I always vowed that I did not want that to happen to the people we see. And so we work really hard by doing surveys for the people that we're seeing for this grant and making sure that the technology is being used 6 months after we're done seeing them and another 6 months after that. And then we make sure they get a magnet with our phone number on it
right,
in case
right.
anything happens and they need more support.
Great.
But our whole grant was set up through DHS for us to help people stay living in a home of their own or have a goal to live in a home of their own. So right now, we only can go in group homes or assisted living or nursing homes if the person has a goal to go back home or
sure.
to a hospital setting. We can
this
go
for
in there.
Any age as well?
Yes. So we can see all ages. The youngest person we've seen to date is 2 years old. And I think the oldest person we've seen to date is about 92. So
wow.
we have a great range, all disabilities. The person that qualifies for our grant is someone who's on Medicaid and they have a county service. And like I said, they live either in a home of their own or they have a goal to live in a home of their own.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. That's so interesting to know that from age 2 up to 90. And that's fantastic.
Yes.
So now talk about the funding piece.
Yes. So right now, our funding comes directly from the Department of Human Services, Disability Services Unit. And so our ability to see people It can be assessments, it can be training. We have deliverables on both. We're supposed to see 300 people a year, and every year we see more people than that. So I think this year we're going to see about 325 to 340 people altogether. And that doesn't count how many times we go out and do their setup and training too. And so we have seen people for all of our services. What we typically do are we do look at communication devices. So for a child or an adult that's nonverbal, we look at using a computer or technology to be able to speak, and that person is using that technology because they don't have a voice, like I'm using my voice right now.
Sure.
So that computer or communication device becomes their voice. And we have our speech therapists that are trained in only doing that. It's called augmentative communication and alternative communication, AAC. Mm-hmm. And so then they're experts in that. And then we have occupational therapists that can look at if the person can't touch the device to have it work. We can use switches, we can use eye gaze, we can use head ability to move around and dwell.
Sure.
And then we can use mounts so that we can mount it so that the person can use it from their wheelchair, the person can use it from bed, from a table, where it's needed. So that teaming has been critical. Besides doing communication devices, we have our physical therapists that can go into the home and look at power mobility, look at ramps that are needed in the home, and then we look at simple home modifications. So things like grab bars and where they should go, durable medical equipment like a shower chair or hospital bed. Those are things that my physical therapist can work with the doctor to be able to order and get and get paid for by Medicaid. And then our occupational therapists do a lot with the environment. So if a person needs to use special equipment to be able to cook, we do a lot of adaptive cooking. We also do bring out controls for the person to be able to use their voice, a switch, any means that the person has ability to turn their lights off and on, their heat off and on, to be able to do their power door. So we're able to give a person with even very limited motion a lot of ability to do everyday tasks in their home. And especially now that there's a shortage of personal care assistants and people being able to come in like at night or during the day, we're doing more and more where the person has control over things for longer periods of time. So where they do need physical assistance, then they can have that at those critical times. And where that person can be on their own and wants to be, then they can have control over their environment and being able to call for help or get food ordered and things like that on their own. So it's been great.
Wow. And during this time we're going through with COVID-19,
yes.
This is fantastic. Have you seen an uptick in individuals?
Yes.
Using?
What we've seen since COVID-19 is, for one, because we're a state grant, our funding wasn't affected at all by having to go remote for a while. So in March, when everybody had to shut down, we were already doing some of our assistive technology remote because we travel the whole state of Minnesota. And so in our grant, I had written the ability to use remote. So even back in 2013, I wrote that in.
Wow.
Because I wanted to try that to see if it would allow us to see more people and how effective we could be. And so that really helped us to pivot and to be fully remote, and we were fully remote until May when essential workers could go back out again.
Sure.
I would say now we're about 70% remote, and then when we know it's essential to go, we wear our PPE. So we have face masks and face shields. We have shoe covers and gloves and disinfectant and sanitizer, and we are very careful, but we can go when we need to. But what the uptake came from was that a lot of other companies couldn't do remote therapy yet because Medicaid and Medicare didn't approve it right away. It took them a month or two. So then we got a lot of referrals because all of a sudden no one had anyone to help for their assistive technology. And then since then, it is hard for a lot of the schools that we're helping with assistive technology because their remote learning now or their hybrid model isn't allowing them to do as much as they were before. And some of the larger hospitals and clinics aren't doing as much remote or as much in clinic as they were doing before. So that has made the amount of referrals go up for us. So we're really busy. We've been very busy this year, which is good.
Yeah, right. Yeah. That's fantastic that you're busy.
Mm-hmm.
Where do the majority of your therapists come from? And are they contracted all over the state, or do they primarily work for you?
Yes. So all of my consultants are contracted by me because we're highly specialized and trained in what we do. There's not a lot of speech therapists, occupational therapists, physical therapists, or even assistive technology practitioners that know the breadth of technology that we do. So I do hire the consultants because I want to make sure that they have the right background and skill for the people that we need to see.
Mm-hmm.
But they are pivoted all over Minnesota. So they're kind of on the periphery of the Twin Cities. So I have people ready to go up north, you know, ready to go west, east, south. So we're kind of all around. And then we do get together to make sure we're cross-training each other every couple times a year.
Can you share with us some of the other cities you've been in, outstate area, to give us an idea just where you've gone?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So we have been up north, Bemidji, Brainerd, Duluth area, Hibbing. We've been to Ortonville. We've been to the border of South Dakota, which is Ortonville, but also even a little bit further. We have been on the border of Wisconsin. We've been all the way up to Itasca and beyond.
Okay, so great.
Yeah, we've gone
so
a lot.
So to kind of, as we're wrapping up our segment, a quick guideline of how one contacts you and a little bit again about the process so people watching this will know how to take this and run with it because it's a fantastic program.
Yeah, so right now, because we do have a deliverable for the state, the county worker, tribal worker, or the contract case entity usually makes the referral to our program. And we have the referral form on our website called technologyforhome.org. And so the person can call us too, but usually then we have the county worker, contract case entity, or tribal worker make the referral because they have a lot of the background information we need to make sure the person qualifies. And then once the referral is made, then I reach out to the person and make sure that the goals that we have and the needs that they have are what really they need
Great.
At the moment.
Give a quick phone number and we need to wrap it up in 20 seconds.
Yes. Our phone number is 952-921-8334. And that
Say
gets
it over
you to,
one more time.
Yeah, 952-921-8334.
Great. Thanks so much for coming on, Sue. This
yes.
is a fantastic program. And we're going to be right back. Mark Hughes will be up with his guest.
Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. Today we have Nikki Villavicencio, who is a familiar name on this show. She's a co-host here. And she just became, got voted on to the Maplewood City Council, so we want to congratulate her quick. She is also a mom and has received a caddy waiver grant to remodel her kitchens, and she has two at home. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Welcome to the show, Nikki.
Thanks, Mark, for having us.
Hi, Daryl.
This is Daryl, my
Hello, Mark.
My husband and partner. And then this is Allie, my daughter.
Great.
She's eight in third grade. And yeah, so we're just going to give you a little tour of our kitchen.
And congratulations again on your new vote to the Maplewood City Council. That's great news for us.
Well, thank you very much, but it's all done with hard work from help from people like you and Daryl and everybody else.
Well,
so
thank you. Thank you very much. For somebody who wants to go through the process by what you did on trying to get a new kitchen with their caddy waiver, how does that process begin? Can you tell us?
Sure. Well, you know, advocating for this really was a couple year process, if not more, to even convince the county and the folks that run the caddy waiver that this was something that we needed to do. But as anybody knows who eats, they want to be able to have access to the food, right?
Yeah, and there's also must-haves and nice-to-haves, right?
Right, absolutely. And especially being a mom and Daryl being a dad, we really needed to have to be able to function in our own kitchen and be able to provide for our family together as a family unit.
Great.
But really, the services in the state of Minnesota right now, they don't really offer a program or programs or services for families specifically. So that's why the advocacy for this project took years to do, because it really benefits all three of us. But the caddy waiver is actually under Daryl's caddy waiver, under his budget. And so, you know, that's how we were able to do it.
So you were the first in Minnesota to do this?
Well, I don't know if we were the first, to be honest with you. You know, it's, like I said, you know, the system doesn't allow for families to really be able to function together. And so it took a lot of advocacy on behalf, but let me just show you a few of the things that really make it, unique to us.
Yeah.
In our situation.
Before we do that, your advocacy, yeah. Is there anything that you look back that you would have done different now to try to speed up the process?
Well, I think, I guess there wouldn't be anything that I would do differently per se as far as advocacy, but there are definitely things that I know when we go up to the legislature in the next couple of years.
Right.
And when we're talking about reforming these waivers, I have some very concrete things that I can tell the legislature that, hey, we need to work on this. And one of it is, I know your guest before was a occupational therapist. One thing that I would tell the legislature is that in doing waivers, whether it's a physical accommodation like a ramp or an accessible kitchen or a lift or any other type of mobility device that allows us to integrate into the community, we need folks like occupational therapists to kind of look at the situation too. So like when we did the caddy waiver, you're mostly working with contractors,
yep.
that don't have a lot of experience with disability per se.
Right.
And so you really are from basic explaining what you need. And having to just reiterate it over and over and over again. I mean, every time they came over to the house, I made sure that I showed them how I function in a real life situation. If you can tell right now, I'm on the floor. So when I'm at home, I'm not in my wheelchair most of the time, but Daryl is. And then Allie, she gets to jump around in between us. So we had to be able to create an environment that we would all three be able to access.
Right.
So most people have visitors' closets, we have his and her kitchens.
Yes. Yeah. I don't know if you can hear Daryl, but he said we have his and her kitchens.
Yeah, I've heard
and
about that.
And so that's kind of how it's divided up.
Before we begin the tour, may I suggest when we do the legislative planning, when we all get to go back down there again, that your suggestions for the caddy waiver reform are mentioned and then implemented for you to testify.
Absolutely.
I would love for that to happen. Let's do it.
I mean, you know how the organization get together and they plan what they're going to talk about in the upcoming legislations. I'd really like to see you go to bat and get that included and then get it implemented to testify.
Yeah, so really that means we need to get it in the faces of the folks like MNCCD and the State Council on Disability
and different
organizations like that, so then that they know that we'll be talking about it ahead of time and they can say, oh yeah, we support that too.
Mm-hmm.
And because that's the whole thing about disabilities and how they're operating throughout our community now, and true community integration is that we're not really telling each other how they're not working.
Mm-hmm.
and how it's not working for us individually, because I think as disabled people we think it's just us, right? Like we just have to.
Yeah, we're gonna start the tour in a minute, but I want to make one comment. It used to be Regal
sure.
Builders that used to do the home building for the disabled many years ago, and we need to educate the general contractors too on what it takes to do kitchens for the disabled. Okay, Nikki, let's begin that tour if we can.
Okay, so I'm gonna start right here. And I don't know, hold on a sec, Allie. Allie's gonna be my little tour helper, assistant. I first wanna show you how the first part is I can pull out, oh, you're gonna do it? But no, I don't think you can do that.
Yeah, you can.
Oh, look, see, I can pull out this to operate my coffee maker. And then show them the sink, honey.
Okay.
So here's the sink. Show how close it is to the ground. No.
Oh, yes.
Go up, 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 and then pan to the left. See, we have, this is our oven. I'm able to operate it from my level and Daryl's level. So Daryl can zoom over here and access the oven. We have a hot plate right here where I pull out and I make Allie's eggs. She loves over easy eggs. Okay. And then we just scooch it back when I don't use it. And the microwave is at the height for both Daryl and I and Allie to operate in. And then if you want to show up the counter is right at level. You want to add anything, Daryl?
No, and then you'll see Nikki's sink. You probably couldn't tell, but all of her sinks are touch sinks and they're motion sinks, so she doesn't have to.
Yeah, for the water, I see that.
Yeah, she doesn't have to worry about touching it. It will come on.
Mm-hmm.
And then as it transitions from Nikki's height to my wheelchair height, as Allie comes around, she can come around and she can.
And then show the place where Dad sits. Dad sits right there.
That's my little cutout. I sit right up there.
It's good, Allie. See
that? And then you transitioned over to the Lazy Susan. You
show them the Lazy Susan.
Okay.
Do you have Corian countertops there? Yes. Oh, Lazy Susan. That's pretty good.
Transitioned up to my sink.
Yeah.
And then up to my five burner cooktop.
He has a
touch cooktop. I have a touch glass cooktop, vibrator cooktop.
Yeah. Very well done. Very, very well done.
Okay.
Bring it over back by Dan. So we're able to make meals for ourselves and our family. Independently with very little help, and it really is, it's actually monumental to our lives. Like you wouldn't think about it, but if you've never had a kitchen that you can reach, it really changes your life. And it changes the way you do your everyday life, and
it's
and
a little more freedom then.
Yeah, and when I have Allie has friends over, then I can help take care of them together. So it's awesome.
Is there any piece of advice that you would give somebody that's kind of looking to do this?
Yeah, I would say, don't give up on advocating. It takes a lot of energy and time to advocate, and don't be afraid to use the appeal system.
Mm-hmm.
Because, when there are decisions that are made, we can appeal them. And then it goes to a judge, and then other people are looking at the facts. And where you advocate a little bit more. Do you have any advice?
What I would say is be honest with your limitations.
Yeah.
And what you can and cannot do for yourself, and stay strong in them. Because contractors will generally be like, well, why did you want to put this outlet here? Or why did you need this over here? Instead of explaining to them why you need everything the way you need it, just stay strong on it and say, I need it this way to be able to function. And don't let them waver on why they think you need it this way or why they want it moved over this way. Because contractors, this is monumental, like most people said. most of the work that is done for an individual. And we had to convince the county that if you do it for a family, we're saving you money. Right. But also doing it for a family means it's not going to work 100% of the time for me, and it's not going to work 100% of the time for Nikki, but it is going to work about 85% of the time for both of us.
Right.
And the fact that we had to learn to compromise and to understand what we can and cannot live with.
Okay.
The fact that we had to learn to compromise and we had to decide what we can and cannot live with, that means Nikki was able to get a USB port down by her kitchen.
Right.
I was able to get a USB port by my cooktop. But originally, I was only the one that was supposed to have those USB ports.
Right.
And I had to convince the contractors that this kitchen wasn't made just for me. It was made for her, too.
So one for all and all for one, yep.
That's really what it is.
Yeah.
Is to understand the art of compromising and be true to it and stay with it.
Well, I'm glad you both were on the show today. Thank you to you and Allie and Nikki. I enjoyed having you on as our special guest today. And as you've learned, there's plenty of free advice out there, and you just got to go for what your own needs are. And it gets to be that simple. But Nikki, congratulations again. Thanks for being on the show. Take care, Daryl, and we'll see you all soon, okay?
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for being on.
Well, as promised, it was a quick moving half hour, and I want to thank Nikki Villavicencio and Daryl Paulson for being my special guests today and talking about their new kitchen remodel at home. And Joan Willshire sure had an exciting show, didn't you?
Absolutely. Sue Redepenning with Technology for Home. We learned a lot, and it's going to be fantastic for people with disabilities to be able to stay in their home with great new technology.
Yeah, and it's very important, especially as where some of us are working from home and
exactly.
trying to stay at home longer.
Timing is perfect.
That's exactly right. Well, thank you, Joan, for being here today.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Sue. Very good to have you and see you again.
Thank
and
you.
We'll see you all next time on Disability Viewpoints. Thanks for watching. I'm Mark Hughes. Bye for now.